In this episode, I'm going to talk about the flipped classroom. Why? Because you've spent months, years, weeks, decades putting together your beautiful videos, and guess what? Your students are not watching them. What can you do to make your students love your videos? Welcome to episode 6 of Ask Sabramowicz, where you ask your instructional design questions and I, Anna Sabramowicz, your host, answers them. So, today we have a fabulous question and I'm so pleased because it comes from somebody who actually was one of the first people to tweet out and comment on our broken coworker demo. But enough of that, let's get to his question.
Rick asks, only 28% of my students are watching the required videos before lab. Waste of resource or evidence of different learning styles?
Rick, great question. And thank you so much. Now, it's a little difficult to answer this question because there's so many things to think about. And basically what this video is asking you to ask even more questions because you need to ask these questions because video is so, there's so many levels. There's so many levels to this. And I'm going to address your question about learning styles, but probably not in the way that we all think about learning styles. Anyways, so first, let's go back to the magic board. You want to increase your video views. I'm thinking that's what you want to do. And my friend, you are super, super lucky. Why? Because you actually have data. So many of us have tons of videos and tons of courses, and you never actually get to measure how many people are engaging with those videos, how many people are watching them, how many people are applying them. So the fact you actually have that data is awesome because now every single tweak you do, you can actually measure the impact. So here's some things to think about. Now, you have your 28% of how many students are actually watching your videos. And I want you to think about what would optimal, what would that desired be? And is it 100% views? Is that realistic, right? So think about what that means. And also, what does that translate to into the classroom? Because, and I'll get into this later, but think about if 28% of your students are watching the videos, and 98% of them are passing the class. Where does the video fit in? And like you said, is it a useless resource or is it something that's provided, but they're finding alternate ways to supplement that knowledge? So there's a question, there's a biggie. Now, when your students are watching the videos, and I don't know how much data you actually have, you have to figure out, are they actually never even trying to watch the video? Which to me means that they don't see the relevance of it or the context, so you haven't sold them on it. And also, if they are starting to watch it, are they dropping off at a certain point? So are many of them attempting it at the beginning and they're seeing something that maybe they don't find very contextual, doesn't get to the point right away, and all of a sudden they're like, ah, these videos aren't worth my time, and they're actually never finishing them. And then the next time you assign another video, they use their past experience to guide that one and never moving through on it. Now, so really what here is kind of important is context. So if they're never attempting your videos, they're never getting through to actually clicking on them, it's because you haven't put those videos in context. But that's just one small part, right? Context is huge, but one small part of video. So then there's the other point of video, which is production. And you have to think about things like, is the sound quality good? Is if the sound quality is good, but let's say it's quite an extended type of video, maybe people would rather enjoy it in a podcast. Maybe they'd rather listen to it while they're cycling or walking somewhere. And that's when, you know, I have to talk about learning styles. I don't think there is learning styles as far as, you know, one person only likes to learn visually or one person really likes to listen to audio or read. For me, some people are better at consuming information, and it depends on the information, better than others in certain ways. So what that means is, if I have a lot of information, I'd rather have it in a text format. I don't want to listen to it in a podcast. I actually, or watch a video. Sometimes what I want to do is just read it so I can scan it, because I read really fast and really well, and I retain that information better. So maybe you want to think about providing the same information in a text format for some students. And it also depends on the type of information it is. If it's a how-to, I want to see it. I want to see it hands-on, and I prefer video. I don't want a step-by-step process. I want to see the action play out. So it's not that I'm a specific type of learner or that I have a specific type of learning style, but different kinds of information I prefer to consume differently. And that really depends on your comfort level with that media, with them, and with that content as well. So you have to think about that. And you know, sometimes I think what happens too is when people are assigned to do work on their own, you have to think about if they have the time, if somebody's supporting them while they're on their own to actually engage in those videos. So if these are students, do they have a team, a support group that says, hey, you guys, let's get together and watch these videos before class starts? Or if this is even a work environment and your boss is expecting you to go to some workshop, is your boss actually saying, hey, you know, it's okay if you take half an hour today just to watch these videos, because I know that's what you need to be able to be productive in that workshop. So is there support in their own space? Or maybe they need to book an appointment with themselves to remind them that this is a part of their learning. So duration is huge as well. The other part that video is able to do now is you're able to embed questions, and you're able to embed questions in the video. And I don't want you to think that you have to remaster anything that you're doing. Sometimes what you can do is ask a question at the end of the video, like I usually do, or what you can do is have questions that are assigned that somebody would submit when they come to class or they're ready to answer because they've watched those videos. Or the other thing with duration is if somebody only has, like, you know, you could say, if you guys only have 10 minutes, well, then skip all this stuff, and this is the essential part in the video. Start at 2 minutes and 33 seconds. That's where you want to start. So giving people those opportunities to quickly engage with your video, and for those who, you know, just being realistic, maybe you don't have half an hour, you only have 5 minutes, here's what you need to skip to get the gist of it, so that it's not all or nothing, because you want to be negotiating that time. You're always fighting with something else. And if you said, you know, some people aren't visual learners and maybe they don't like watching video, well, you could ask your class, say, how many of you watched TV last night? Probably most hands will go up. Or how many of you watched music videos on television? So the thing is that you're fighting with all those other awesome media sources out there. So you have to add context, or you have to make it very easy for them to get to the most important parts. Okay, so now you could do all this fabulous stuff and you know, optimize your video, and I'll actually provide you with some resources in the comments or in the description below for optimizing video, but you may not want to reimagine all your videos. What you want to do is see where they add the relevance that you need. So who you need to talk to is your students. You need to do some surveying, my friend. So what I think you want to first get a little bit of an idea of is, what are they already watching and where are they watching it? Because sometimes it's about forcing people to use a platform they're not familiar with, or you want to maybe engage them where they already are. Maybe they have a Facebook group that they're already a part of, or maybe they're on Facebook and you want to create a group where you can stream some videos if you want, or create a YouTube playlist for them. Who knows? Also, ask them to give you some feedback. Like, let's say you're asking some questions saying, you guys, I know that some students don't watch all the videos. Now, what I'm trying to do is figure out how to make these videos more engaging for them, and I have some questions for you. Now, don't ask them how you would improve the videos, because a lot of people don't know that. What you want to find out is, what kinds of videos do they find engaging already? And what was the last time they watched a video that was really useful to them? Was it because they could apply it right away? Was it because it was broken down into fun steps and extremely dynamic? Or, you know, what are those things that they're already using that they can show you examples of? Because the more they share those good examples of what they're engaging with and what they're learning from, then you can then start figuring out, working backwards, and say, okay, they're liking this video because it has the first 5 steps in the very beginning. They're liking this video because they're able to use this stuff right away. Maybe my application process is a little too delayed for them. So how can I make that time closer? How can I make that context and usefulness closer? And also, when you think about it, when the videos are being played, maybe the students don't see the value because there's no consequences to not watching the video. Like, let's say, and I've had this this teacher with me who, what he used to do is, if somebody came in and they weren't prepared for class, for the virtual sessions that we were running, what he would do is he would say, oh, let me give you a recap. So everybody else would have to sit there while the instructor would give a recap to the student who wasn't prepared of what they had missed. And I thought about the fact that, one, the other students who had taken the time to prep were not being recognized and were in fact being punished for prepping, because now they had to listen to this information twice. And the student who came in late or who did not prepare was basically being coddled and being told, it's okay, don't worry about it, I'll always catch you up because we need you to function and be a productive member of the group. So here's the thing to consider. Let's say somebody misses a video or never watches it. What do you do to make sure that they're still functioning well when they come to class? And if what you're doing is giving them a 30-second, you know, summary of what the gist of the video was, maybe the video is redundant. Maybe all you need to do is put together some 30-second videos of going, you know, you're going, hey, this is the gist of what we're going to do. And you can even play that right before class starts. So there's that alternative. And also, you have to think about what your students feel are the consequences of actually watching those videos. What are the consequences of being prepared? And if that's being rewarded, maybe the students who come in prepared can give you some questions and answers. You provide some questions, they give you answers right away as they come into class, and they get to have maybe 5 extra points in their quiz because they came in prepared. So there's a way to almost gamify that without alienating the people who are not prepared, but rewarding the people who do take the time and make the effort, because you need to make that distinction. So, and context, always. Why are you asking them to watch these videos? Why are they so useful? Are they? And would you watch them? Would you enjoy them? If you're bored of your videos, they probably are as well. Well, Rick, that was huge and a great question. And I seriously enjoyed thinking about it, because I didn't just think about it from the contextual point and surveying the learner, but I talked to my creative director, Ryan Martin, who is also involved in video. And he talked about all these other things like, my God, this guy has data, that's great. Now you can measure things. So tweak, I'd love to hear about how you're asking these questions, applying it, and if you have any more details to add, please do so in the comments. Also, anybody else, how are you using video? What are your strategies? What are you applying? How are you integrating all these things? Are you asking these kinds of questions? Am I asking, should I be asking other questions? Please, please put your comments in the comments, and I seriously will talk to you next time at Ask Sabramowicz, and please subscribe. Thank you.